Ja, varmt välkomna hit ikväll till den här kvällen som vi ska ägna Kaija Saariaho, tonsättaren, och också naturligtvis Simone Weil. La Passion de Simone ska vi få höra Kaija Saariahos verk. Vi är väldigt glada för att ni har kommit hit i dessa tider, och vi är väldigt glada för det samarbete som vi har med judisk kultur i Sverige. Och jag ska börja med att lämna över till dig, Lissi Scheja.
Tack, tack Katarina. Hörs jag? Ja. I will speak English. My name is Lissi Scheja. I'm the director of Jewish culture in Sweden. We are extremely happy, just want to say a couple of words, for this wonderful cooperation with the Royal Opera. So this is our first cooperation with the Royal Opera, but it's also a very special occasion. It's also the first time that Kaija's music is being performed at the Royal Opera. And it's the first time that Christian Carlsen is conducting here. So it's very special. And I have to commend the Royal Opera and its leadership for really embracing this beautiful piece, this project, and taking it under its wings. And I think these days it's extremely important with this type of cooperation, coming together, dialogue and exchange, especially in the arts and culture. So I want to thank Christian Carlsen for the initiative, and you know, it's one of those magic moments that everything comes into places. Christian comes with an initiative, the opera embraces, Anne-Sophie von Otter is with us, and of course Kaija Saariaho could come and be with us on this occasion. So I am going to leave the stage, and I just want to wish you all a meaningful evening, and we hope to see you next time in another cooperation, hopefully with more than 50 people. But enjoy the evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lissi Scheja. Thank you. And please welcome on stage the composer, Kaija Saariaho. Please come. So, welcome, Kaija Saariaho, to the Royal Swedish Opera. We are so happy to have you here and to perform your piece, La Passion de Simone, this evening.
Thank you very much.
Yes. So, we are sitting here in the middle of this pandemic, and only 50 people are here because of the rules of the Swedish government. So my first question to you is, have you as a composer been affected in any way of this pandemic?
Of course, of course. We all have affected. Practically, I'm of course spent most of my life alone in my working room writing my music. So in that sense, I'm very used to that kind of life. But of course, most concerts have been canceled. Many premieres, music that I've written, in fact, past 5 years, I'm still waiting to hear now, because starting from March, I had some really important dates which have been postponed. So that has, of course, changed a lot. But what is the biggest change is, of course, to have to stop thinking what's really going on in the world.
Mm-hmm. Talking a bit about your Swedish history in Sweden, you got the Polar Prize in 2013. And you have been here sometimes, invited by your friend and colleague Esa-Pekka Salonen at Östersjöfestivalen and Berwaldhallen. And you are also in high esteem, I would say, among Swedish musicians and orchestras. And do you have any other Swedish connection that I don't know of?
I have very close familial connection, because my sister lives here, and her children live here, and are half Swedish. So, of course, for that reason, I know Stockholm well and have seen also Stockholm and Sweden change a lot since my early days.
And you know Swedish, I have understood that you, when we speak Swedish, you understand.
I understand really practically everything. But because I don't speak it so much, and I need to speak other languages daily. So when I speak about it, I'm sorry not to speak Swedish right now, but my Swedish has become very childish.
Well, talking about childishness, you are now one of the most successful and respected composers in the world. But if we should start from the beginning in Helsinki, was it clear from you from the beginning that you were going to be a composer?
No, not at all. My family was not a musical family, not a special, especially cultural family. And I was very shy child. I always imagined music, but you know, when you're a child, you don't compare your mind with other people. So I thought it's normal to imagine music.
Yes, you heard music and you asked your mother to sort of shut it
turn,
down.
Turn off the pillow, but I mean, this is what she told me. I don't remember that.
No, okay.
But it's a nice story.
Yeah. But after a while you started to you went to conservatory and you started studying composing, and you started in Paavo Heinonen's class, and it was not easy perhaps to get into that class.
No, and before that, of course, I had many instrumental studies, and it was only very little by little I realized that I really need to be a composer, otherwise that my life seemed quite meaningless. And so there was this urge in me, and even if his class was full, I just decided to go in and sit there until he accepts me. So that must have been a very weird situation because I was so shy. But anyway, it worked out.
Yeah, it did. Korvat Auki, tell me about that. What does it mean?
Means open ears, or yes, open ears, open your ears.
How do you say it in Finnish?
Korvat Auki.
Korvat Auki.
It depends how you say it. If you say Korvat Auki, it means open your ears. And that was our message, of course, because it was a group of quite dynamic young composers. Esa Pekka was there, Jouni Kaipainen, Magnus Lindberg, many others, some great musicians. And we were really annoyed that there were these established composers like Joonas Kokkonen and Auli Sallinen, among others, but really being the most important, because they had composed big operas. And we had the feeling that the establishment was only following them, because then they were brought to abroad, and we had a feeling that there was no place for us. So, and there was not only for us, but really truly modern music. And a lot of modern music that was not performed in Finland. So that's what we started doing.
Mm-hmm. And then you left Finland and you went to Darmstadt to continue your studies there?
No, I went to Darmstadt for summer courses.
Okay.
And there I met Brian Fernihau, who was famous teacher at that time, and Klaus Huber, and they were teaching in Freiburg in Germany. And then that's where I applied. I was thinking that I was I would go there maybe for 1 year and then return to my teacher in Finland, because he was really so important for me. But I never returned.
Mm, yeah. And then you left Germany for France. Mm. And you went to IRCAM, Institute for Research of Acoustics and Music in Paris. And you have stayed in Paris since the beginning of the 1980s.
Yeah, more or less. Yes, yes,
yes. Yes. So could you take us with us into IRCAM? How was it to be there in the beginning of the 1980s?
Well, it was there were some really important new studios in the big universities in United States. There was in Boston, MIT, there was Stanford. There was, of course, one studio here, EMS studio, mm-hmm. in Stockholm, which I also visited. But those American studios brought very new kind of technology. And then it was brought to this IRCAM, founded by Pierre Boulez. And I had started working in studios already in Finland and was very interested in sound. And what I wanted was to understand more sound, really, really the acoustic phenomenon, and why one instrument sounds different than other, because of their harmonic spectrum was different. And that was how I started working with really on computer technology. And it was very clumsy at that time. We didn't realize it because it was brand new. But the computers were enormous. The hard disk was big like this. I could hardly carry it. So it was very different kind of thing, but it was exciting because in IRCAM that time there were acousticians. There were psychoacousticians, a lot of programmers. So there were really interesting collaborations. And that gave me a lot to also for my orchestration, to understand sound. That was something that interested me since always very much.
Mm-hmm. So did you learn how to program these computers?
Well, I
yourself?
Had to.
Yes.
Of course I had to learn, but never very well, I must say. Let's stay honest, because yes. It was not my interest. My interest was always to realize the music. So I'm not that kind of fanatic of technology. You know, I just imagine things and then want to find sometimes with technology, ways to realize it. Mm-hmm. But yes, well, I worked very much with sound synthesis, so creating with computer sounds to see how I can combine them with instrumental sounds and that kind of things.
Mm. And you will be sitting here actually on here on parquet during this performance, mm. and you will do some mixing of the sound.
Oh yeah, I mixed the because there is recorded actress voice, and as I know the piece so well, I know how it should blend to the orchestra and soprano solo and choir. And then on that tape part there is, or electronic part, it's not tape, it's on computer, there are also sounds that it's kind of adding to the orchestration. It's blending to the orchestration, and we don't hear where orchestra stops and this sound starts. So it's just what I have imagined and then realized.
Mm-hmm. You have written quite a lot of music with based or inspired by poetry and texts and with singers. And you have written 5 operas.
Or 6.
Or 6?
I think so.
Yeah, okay, let's see. It's L'amour de loin, of course,
yes.
The first one,
yeah.
In 2000.
Yeah.
That was for Salzburg, wasn't it?
It was Salzburg,
yeah.
Festival.
Then it was Adriana Mater.
Yes.
And that was a commission from the Opéra Paris.
Yes.
Yes. And then it was...
Then there was La Passion de Simone.
Ah, okay. You counted it as an opera.
Yeah.
Okay.
But it was created same year as Adriana Mater.
Mm.
So I call it oratorio. But in fact, this is the second time ever that we have a non-staged performance tonight.
Mm. Because it was Peter Sellers who directed all these 3.
Yes.
And he also directed the first performance of La Passion.
La Passion,
yes,
also.
Yeah.
And then Emily.
Yes,
which
Emily.
Is monodrama.
Yeah. Also about a French female philosopher.
Yes. Emily. Very different. Emily du Châtelet.
Yes.
And then Only the Sound Remains.
Yes.
And then something called Innocence, which was supposed to be premiered last summer. And I hope next summer will happen.
Okay, that is the latest news, that it will happen next summer in Aix-en-Provence.
Mm.
Okay,
mm.
And that is an opera that Sophie Oksanen has written. Mm. Yes. There are quite strong female protagonists in these operas, especially, of course, in Adriana Mater, Emily, and La Passion de Simone. Of course, you are a composer. You are first of all a composer, but you are also a woman. So I just want to ask you, has that ever been sort of a problem for you? Have you felt sort of restriction, or has it been harder for you being a woman and being a composer?
Well, I was never a man, but in the beginning it was very complicated because it was already complicated for me because I was thinking, I want so much to be a composer. But how me, you know, shy, not very great instrumentalist, how could I be a composer? Who are all the other women before me? And there were much more than I knew then. Nobody knew. But still, so first of all, I had to realize that this is so important for me that I just have to do it. And then, but then people around me, of course, they had the same reflection. The people at Sibelius Academia, they were professors who didn't want to teach me. Because they said, oh, you're a pretty girl, soon you get married. So my time is too precious to give you lessons. So that was very normal that time.
Yeah.
So at some point, my music started to be played a lot, and I realized that my colleagues started thinking, my male colleagues, that it's because I'm a woman. So I don't know. Maybe some of it is true. Maybe at some point I stood out also because I was a woman. So, but I can tell you that the beginning was quite tough anyway.
Mm. And I think I think you could see that choosing those subjects for your operas and this oratorio, I think it might have something to do with yourself being a woman. Maybe you could...
Well, maybe, but you know, every composer is choosing subjects that really speak to you. This piece is, for me, maybe the most important piece I ever wrote. It's dedicated to my two children. I wrote this piece on life and thoughts of Simone Weil, because I accidentally bought one of her books with her writings when I was 15, and never stopped reading it. And actually, I never understood totally what she's saying, but I'm still trying. And I don't agree with her thoughts, but they make me forced to create my own opinions, and they are very contemporary. When she speaks about our compassion and how that compassion can become action, that's something that we really would need to understand today.
Mm. Was that one of the reasons that you dedicated it to your children? It was that kind of a message to them? Or
it's kind of testament to my children. I mean, it's kind of mental testament. I hope they... yes, that's the reason. Mm. It was so important for me. That's, in a way, the most important thing I could give to them. Mm.
Maybe we should say something about Simone Weil for those who don't know her so much. She was a French philosopher. She was born in 1909 in Paris, and she was born in a Jewish kind of bourgeoisie family. She had a very intelligent elder brother who became a very brilliant mathematician. And she herself was also very, very intelligent. And she went to École Normale Supérieure. Two female students came into that. So she's actually one of the first educated philosophers, female philosophers.
Mm. And the other one was Simone de Beauvoir.
Yes. Yeah. And they never really understood each other, I think.
I don't think they liked each other.
No,
I
they
mean,
were
because they were living very different kind
yeah,
of...
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. And after school, she was a teacher, philosopher teacher, but then she took a year off and she went to a factory, to work in a factory. Because very, very early, she was... obsessed with this feeling of suffering.
Suffering, but social injustice.
Yes.
Yes.
Even when she was a child, when she heard about the soldiers in the First World War, that they didn't have food, she herself felt that she shouldn't eat so much and so on. And further on in her life, she was part of the resistance in the Spanish Civil War, and then at the end she came to London as part of the French resistance, and that's where she became ill in tuberculosis, and then she refused to eat in the hospital, so she died. So this is a piece that you have made together with Amin Maalouf, the librettist who also wrote L'Amour de Loin, yes, and with Peter Sellers. So could you just say something about how you have composed it? Because this is a special structure.
Yes. There were many discussions with Amin, but also three of us, because it was Peter who commissioned it to Vienna Festival. And it was a special Mozart year, and he was asking for Requiem, but then I couldn't imagine it, and then this idea of Simone Weil came up, because I had seen Peter reading her texts in the rehearsals of L'Amour de Loin. And I once asked, why are you reading Simone Weil here? And he said, I'm sure she was Amin Maalouf's inspiration when he wrote the text for L'Amour de Loin. Then I asked Amin, so you have been reading Simone Weil? And Amin said, what? Who? So he had no idea who it was.
Okay.
And because she was for me always so important, so we decided with Peter to introduce her to Amin. And so Amin brought a lot of these biographical elements into it. Peter was, of course, knowing her, his own actions, were interested of this social concern, and well, of course, the spiritual searching also. Mm-hmm. So little by little, it was like a puzzle. And then, because her great ideal was Jesus. Mm. So we started to think that in a way her life was this like a passion play, like stations of cross. And that's why we then decided to, there are often 14 stages of stations of cross, but here then we decided to create 15 movements, and after that, then Amin and me continued collaborating, and then everything which is sung here tonight by Anne-Sophie, it's Amin's text, and it's coming from the mouth of a woman who is speaking to Simone, and everything which will be we hear from loudspeakers, Dominique Blanc's voice, that those are quotations of her writings and thoughts.
Yeah, which she was famous for her aphorisms. So some of these lines that we hear the speakers say, they are really coming from Simone Weil, and they are also very clear and accurate.
I'm not always quite sure they are very clear, but they are her thoughts, and they are not my thoughts. I don't sign them, but they are her thoughts, and that's they are there to reflect her personality.
Yes. We are so much looking forward to hearing this piece. So I thank you so much for introducing it. And
thank you.
I can only say Korvat Auki to everyone.
Bravo.
Yeah. Because we will have an intermission now, and then the musicians will come on stage, and then we will hear this piece. Thank you so much for being here, Kaija Saariaho.
I'm so
here
glad.
In Stato. And thank we hope you. To hear more from you here on stage. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks.